Is that
we're in danger. Yeah.
Like, for real?
Hey, Best Pally, I'm Allie, and I just found out that
I don't want to breathe.
There have been some recent developments in the news that made me realize that the air quality around you is potentially not great.
And a low air quality can shorten your lifespan, cause asthma, decrease your cognitive function. Am I getting dumber right now? Probably.
Okay, what are we gonna do? Well, I found out that you can measure air quality and it is constantly changing based on where you are, so I am going to get to the bottom of this for you. Please insert air quality and bottom joke here. This CO2 meter is going to tell me just how scared I should be in dozens of different scenarios that I'm gonna test for you throughout this video in order to get some strategies to avoid poisoning ourselves. First test is in my home. The benchmark for well-ventilated is under 800, so we are good. Though I have heard of apartments having really high CO2, so I'm glad to see this, and just because mine has good airflow doesn't mean that everyone's does. Now, my studio is quite low, because I'm the only one in here breathing. He doesn't. But the more people in a space with less ventilation, the more the CO2 will start to accumulate and the air quality will go down. But I do want to know how sensitive this thing is. Can I get those numbers up? Definitely can. We're in the yellow and red. I should stop talking. Now that we've established my motor mouth is contributing to poor air quality, let's try the next test outdoors in LA specifically. Smells like sidewalk stars and failed auditions. Now, I would expect this to be garbage, but we're coming in at 410, which 400 is the baseline for outdoors, so you won't see any lower than that. How? What? Why? This meter specifically measures CO2, so it's ignoring all the other stuff that might be in there, like nitrogen oxide, carbon monoxide, ozone, and particulate matter. I feel like I could grab it out of the air in LA. So it's not a perfect tool, but it is a good measure of ventilation in a room, which is a good proxy for all that other bad stuff building up. If CO2 is going up, probably all those other pollutants and viruses and bacteria are going up, so high CO2 means you're probably more at risk of getting sick, that's what I mean. But still, CO2 by itself is poison to humans, so if we find a place that gets us over 1400 ppm, it's been shown that my basic decision-making ability could be down by 25%, and my strategic complex thinking down by 50%. Now, the next test is in my home while the stove is on, and this is the main reason that I started looking into air quality, because I have a gas stove, and there's been a proposal to ban them all together because that's how bad they are. It's releasing right now methane, formaldehyde, particulate matter. It is combusting the gas, and all of that has now been proven to cause asthma. Scientists published a paper saying that 13% of childhood cases of asthma were probably because of gas stoves. If they didn't have them, the kids would not be sick. That's so messed up. What this is releasing, the levels can get so bad that the EPA would say, this is illegal if it was outside, but it's fine because we're inside. It is so dumb that there are no regulations on the inside. Within minutes of turning on the stove, it could be the same as standing next to a highway with a bunch of cars driving past you. And at least outside, the fumes disperse. Here, it's just collecting along with my angry breath. And you should have the vent on, and I don't, and I was proving a point, but let's get it on right now. Just as I'm turning on the vent, we hit about 600. You should make sure that it vents to outside, not just a fan that's circulating everything still back into you. And you should leave the vent on while you're cooking and then sometime after to make sure it continues to pull all of that out. And what's really scary is that even when they're not on, they still emit toxic compounds like benzene and 21 other plus chemicals. So if you can switch to a non-gas stove, do that. Otherwise, very much always use your vent. Also, cooking on the back burners is better because then it'll reach the vent better. Oops.
And if you don't do that, it could be as bad as living with a smoker secondhand smoke level. And it's also bad for your pets, so if you're not doing it for you, at least do it for Braxton.
Checking my public gym with lots of puffing people, and we are good. That was definitely one I worried about, so thank goodness.
Oh no, 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 no!
I wasn't trying to run a test, I was just having dinner, Christine's watching TV, and then I just watched the numbers rise up. Alarm went off, you saw, and now it's red. I'm glad I left it on. I guess my place is not as well ventilated as I thought. And that's so scary too, because I just cooked, so now all of that combustion stuff is in here with... Oh, wait. Hey! Oh, I'm a dummy. I just opened a soda water with carbon dioxide in it, which is exactly what we're measuring, so I guess we're just testing that the meter works and my brain doesn't. That is a relief. I thought that my place was killing me. The next big one I was worried about is my sleep, and it turns out I should be concerned. I tested last night, and as soon as I got into bed, it jumped up to over 1,000 and stayed there the whole night. 1,000 is NIOSH's limit for what is generally thought of as good air exchange, so I should think about opening a window when I sleep. It's crazy that there's something going on that's invisible that's harming me, and even if it was visible, I'm unconscious when it's happening. Well, this has been enlightening already, and now we really need to up the ante. Let's go to some aggressive and varied places.
Testing in the very crowded LAX. It is hot and stuffy in here. It feels like dirty air. And it is not. I'm so surprised. I heard that potentially the most dangerous part of flying is being in the airport and not in the air. But it seems I'm doing okay. Here's what I'm really interested in, this tiny little cabin. We're at 1300. We're at 2000 and just hit 2001. Switched into red. Nervous, they haven't even closed the cabin yet. And airplane cabins were a big concern during COVID. Ooh, I think they turned on ventilation because we are back down. I'm interested to see how this goes though. The door is closed and whenever we're up in the air. We're taking off now and it's dropping. We've been in the air for about an hour now and we are back to green and it's been staying here steadily. This is really surprising to me because it's such a small area. Descending and these numbers are ascending. Interesting. I turned on the vent, but it has zero effect. While we were sitting on the tarmac, it got up to 1400. So it seems the most dangerous times are before takeoff and after touchdown. Dropping back down now. In the not so crowded Pittsburgh airport, we are in the 500s. Outdoors in Pennsylvania, we are in the low 400s. That's fresh.
Oh no, the alarm's going off.
Is that
we're in danger. Yeah.
Like, for real?
I guess. Your place doesn't ventilate well?
Well, I just blew right on it.
It was 800 when it was sitting by itself, and then we came in here and started setting it off, I guess.
It could be worse.
I'm testing two people in a small vehicle. Thank you for being the driver for this experiment. Ooh, we're in the orange now. We've hit over 1,200. Stop breathing. Now I'm nervous.
We can't take it now.
Started coming down immediately once you turn the air on. We're now back into the green. Back home from Pittsburgh and I'm next to a bunch of cars, buses. It's all feeling like it's trapped in here. Really hot and it smells like exhaust. But we got nothing registering on here. It's not picking up exhaust, it's picking up CO2, so that's different.
Had to try out some public transportation too. Surprisingly in the green, looks like we're doing okay.
Yep, we hit yellow.
And it's getting more crowded.
After we started driving a bit, it came down significantly. It's much more ventilated than the beginning of a flight.
What? This is shocking. The worst part of my trip by far was the Uber drive home.
It was climbing and climbing. My Uber driver must have been using the recirculate air setting and must have been some sort of crazy super breather. It got over 3,700 and I'm sure it would have gone higher, but I freaked out and opened a window. Then it surprisingly took a while to come down. And before I opened the window, I started getting nauseous. I don't know if that was me reading into it or the fact that I've been traveling and haven't eaten, but I did look it up and between 2,000 and 5,000 ppm, mild nausea is a side effect, along with headache, sleepiness, poor concentration, loss of attention. I definitely needed to open that window.
Why did you bring your Nest thermostat?
It's not! I had to test in another Uber, and this one happens to be four people, which should be way worse, but we're at 950, 60 now? It's because the windows are open.
I have really bad CO2.
I think you have bad methane.
That was a fart joke.
Don't light a match.
Oh. We hit yellow. Even with the windows open, four people can make it over the top.
Stop burping! We're trying to keep it ventilated in here.
No!
So I'm concerned about the next one. This is really why I brought it, because we're about to be in a close quarter space with a lot of people eating and drinking and playing and breathing.
Wow!
I stand corrected. We are well ventilated in.
Just to confirm, I have been all around near lots of people and we are still in the green.
I found a more populated area and we have a hit yellow.
Still not incredibly bad. I mean, I expected high red.
Nick is making fun of me, but that's what I want.
It is.
You can win one at Dave & Buster's, but I have my own.
We're shooting a different video and Max just said that his elevator always smells like the food that people order, so we're checking. That's not too bad, we're still green.
I figure we should test in this gym as well because it's gonna be two of us huffing and puffing that CO2 in this little space. What's gonna happen from green to, I don't know, huffing and puffing for an hour. Turns out we got good ventilation. I was very concerned.
Get the AC going.
This video has been interesting. I love being able to test what you can't see. So, what did we learn? One, CO2 builds up quickly. Two, screw gas stoves. But if you have to have a gas stove, make sure your vent goes to the outside and you use it all the time when you cook. But seriously, screw gas stove. Three, probably open a window while you're sleeping. Even though you're unconscious, you still want your brain functioning well. Four, roll down windows in cars or turn on the air that pulls from the outside, not recirculates. Man, your Uber driver is just a breath factory. 5. The reason you can't win any games at Dave & Buster's is not because they're actively bringing up the CO2 to bring down your cognitive function. And finally, we gotta do this because I know it was killing some of you. Oh, yeah. If you liked this, you'll like seeing when I tested leg compression boots on only one leg to prove if they actually work. I'll put that down there for you. This is pretty awesome.
I can see why people think this works, but we're gonna find out for sure.
Hey Best Pally, I'm Allie, and I wanna know if leg compressors truly help you to recover, or are they not really causing you to bounce back any faster, they're just fooling you with a nice feeling squish. To do this test, I have created the most elegantly designed controlled study